In mid-1945, the US and its allies prepared for a potentially costly invasion of the Japanese mainland. This was preceded by a conventional and firebombing campaign that devastated Japanese cities. The war in Europe concluded on the 8th of May when Germany surrendered, and the allies now turned their full attention to the Pacific War. By July 1945, the Allies' Manhattan Project had produced two types of atomic bombs. The Fat Man, a plutonium implosion-type nuclear weapon, and the Little Boy, an enriched uranium gun-type fission weapon. The 509th Composite Group of the United States Army Air Forces was trained and equipped with a specialized version of the Boeing B-29 Superfortress and deployed to Tinian Island in the Mariana Islands. The Allies called for the unconditional surrender of the Japanese armed forces in the Potsdam Declaration on 26 July 1945 and threatened with the prompt and utter destruction of Japan if they failed to do so. Japan ignored the ultimatum. The consent of the United Kingdom was obtained for the use of atomic bombs, as was required by the Quebec Agreement, and orders were issued on the 25th of July for atomic bombs to be used against Hiroshima, Kokura, Niigata, and Nagasaki. These targets were chosen because they were large urban areas that also held militarily significant facilities. On the 6th of August, the Little Boy bomb was dropped in Hiroshima, killing 70 to 80,000 people in the blast and resulting firestorm alone. 3 days later, the Fat Man bomb was dropped in Nagasaki, killing at least 35,000 in the blast. Over the next 2 to 4 months, the effects of the atomic bombings killed between 90,000 and 146,000 people in Hiroshima and between 39,000 and 80,000 people in Nagasaki. For months afterward, large numbers of people continued to die from the effects of burns, radiation sickness, and injuries compounded by illness and malnutrition. Most of the dead were civilians, although Hiroshima had a sizable military garrison. Japan surrendered to the Allies on the 15th of August, 6 days after the Soviet Union's declaration of war and the bombing of Nagasaki. The Japanese government signed the surrender on the 2nd of September, effectively ending the war. Extensive studies as to the effects of the bombings on the social and political character of subsequent world history and popular culture have been done, and there is to this day still debate concerning the ethical and legal justification for the bombings. Supporters believe that the atomic bombings were necessary to bring a swift end to the war with minimal casualties, while critics argue that the Japanese government could have been brought to surrender through other means, while highlighting the moral and ethical implications of nuclear weapons and the deaths caused to civilians. This lecture will look at how the dropping of atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki have been remembered in popular culture in both the USA and Japan. Perspectives in each country may vary according to where a person finds themselves on the political spectrum. For example, in the US, those who advocate the Good War narrative seek to memorialize the dropping of the atomic bomb as a reminder of America's military capability as a superpower in an era when such a label was mostly irrelevant. As Timothy W. Luke puts it, many 70-something members of the World War II generation wanted a second vindication for Hiroshima and Nagasaki, in as much as these two atomic targets were the most tangible proof of America's nuclear credibility during the Cold War. On the other hand, liberals are more critical towards the USA's military actions and are inclined to not always link those actions to its idealism. In Japan, there are also varying perspectives as to how the war ended. Japanese nationalists are blind to the misplaced aggression of the Imperial Army, and as a result they are not remorseful in any way and thus not prepared to tender an apology for its atrocities. In contrast, the pacifists are inclined to blame Japanese suffering completely on the government and military industry. This absolved the average Japanese citizen of guilt as well as the US military. Now, let us look at a much publicized incident which highlighted the clear fault lines between these different camps. For the 50th anniversary of the end of World War II, the Smithsonian Institute's National Air and Space Museum, or the NASM, proposed an exhibition that would include displaying the Enola Gay, the B-29 superfortress that dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima. As a result, a controversy ensued that demonstrated the competing historical narratives regarding the decision to drop the bomb. During the early 1980s, members of the 509th Composite Group, the Army Air Force unit which was responsible for dropping the bomb, asked for a proper restoration of the aircraft. Their motivations at this time stemmed primarily from the poor conditions of the aircraft. The veterans formed the Committee of the Restoration and Proud Display of the Enola Gay to raise funds. The restoration efforts by the Smithsonian started on the 5th of December 1984. However, as Edward T. Linenthal puts it, the museum felt ambivalence about the plane's eventual display. Linenthal was also on the advisory board of the Enola Gay exhibit. In 1987, the NASM hired Martin Howard as their new director. His vision for the museum differed significantly from previous directors. Howard wanted the museum to be a public conscience that would discuss topics under public debate. His vision included displaying the Enola Gay. At first, the Enola Gay was planned to be displayed at an annex NASM facility near Washington Dulles International Airport. This proposed annex would solve the hassle of disassemble and reassemble of the larger aircrafts. The Enola Gay had recently finished being renovated and the museum had been concerned about transportation and reassemble fees. Therefore, the proposed annex appeared to be a fitting location. They decided to exhibit the Enola Gay at the annex with an accompanying message about the dangers of strategic bombing and escalation. However, this proposal was met with some opposition in the Research Advisory Committee's, or RAC's, meeting in 1988. One of the RAC's members, Admiral Noel Gaylor, believed that any exhibition of the Enola Gay would imply that we, the USA, are celebrating the first and so far the only use of nuclear weapons against human beings. Heeding this warning, the RAC tabled the discussion and decided to first find out what the public opinion was. For 16 months, a series of talks, panels, and exhibits on strategic bombings in World War II followed. Meanwhile, the proposed annex did not receive the necessary funding. In December 1991, the NASM Advisory Board discussed the possibility of a World War II exhibit that featured the Enola Gay. While the advisory board was unanimous in agreeing that the Enola Gay is an artifact of pivotal significance and that it should be exhibited, they asked the museum to avoid discussing the decision to drop the bomb and to consider an alternative site, such as an armed services museum. Tom Crouch, chairman of the museum's aeronautics department and lead curator Michael Nerfield, led the team in charge of the exhibition. Taking the board's considerations into account, they decided to go with an exhibition entitled The Crossroads, The End of World War II, The Atomic Bomb, and The Origins of the Cold War. They also began discussions with Japan about borrowing artifacts from Hiroshima and Nagasaki to be included in the exhibit in order to present a balanced narrative. The exhibition's first script was completed in January 1994. It consisted of more than 300 pages of texts and illustrations divided into five sections, namely Fight to the Finish, Decision to Drop the Bomb, Delivering the Bomb, Ground Zero, and Legacy of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. In 1993, Executive Director of the Air Force Association, or the AFA, sent a letter to Howard expressing concerns that the exhibition did not present an accurate portrayal of the war. He argued the proposed exhibition treats Japan and the United States as if their participation in the war were morally equivalent. If anything, incredibly, it gives the benefit of opinion to Japan, which was the aggressor. Japanese aggression and atrocities seem to have no significant place in this account. Initially, the NASM held a meeting with the AFA to discuss the concern. The NASM found the AFA's position to be too extreme, and the AFA felt the NASM was deaf to their criticisms. Soon, veterans and military groups such as the American Legion also began voicing their dissent. They felt that the exhibition dishonored veterans by discussing the controversy over the decision to drop the bomb and displaying graphic photos of atomic bomb victims. The American Senate also unanimously proclaimed the script as revisionist and offensive to many World War II veterans. Interestingly, The Senate criticisms contradicted the AFA, who had acknowledged the proposed exhibition treated, who acknowledged that the proposed exhibition treated the men of the 509th with respect. In response, Howard wrote and on the 7th of August 1994 an editorial in the Washington Post. He wrote, "We want to honor the veterans who risked their lives and those who made the ultimate sacrifice, but we also must address the broader questions that concern subsequent generations, not with a view of criticizing or apologizing or displaying undue compassion for those on the ground that day, as some may fear, but to deliver an accurate portrayal that conveys the reality of the atomic war and its consequences." But the unrelenting media attacks and criticisms led Howard to consult military historians, and on their recommendations, the NASM produced a revised script. During the revision process, the section discussing the legacy of the bomb shrank dramatically. This in turn evoked angry responses from Japan. Photographs of bomb victims as well as the artifacts from the bombing were mostly removed from the exhibition, despite originally having been used to create a balanced narrative. However, the section on Japanese wartime atrocities was expanded. But these revisions still did not fully satisfy the opposing groups and sparked a new wave of criticism. Other groups asked for the reinstallation of certain elements, including the photographs of Japanese victims, signing a statement that called for the historical cleansing of the script as being unconscionable. These groups also urged the Smithsonian to resist pressure to write what they called patriotically correct history. Ultimately, the script would be revised at least 5 times. On the 30th of January 1995, the Smithsonian announced a decision to replace the exhibition with a smaller display and made the following statement. "We made a basic error in attempting to couple an historical treatment of the use of atomic weapons with the 50th anniversary commemoration of the end of the war. In this important anniversary year, veterans and their families were expecting, and rightly so, that the nation would honor and commemorate their valor and sacrifice. They were not looking for analysis, and, frankly, we do not give enough thought to the intense feelings such an analysis would evoke." On the 2nd of May 1995, Howard resigned. He said, "I believe that nothing less than my stepping down from the directorship will satisfy the museum's critics and allow the museum to move forward." He later reflected, "The dispute was not simply about the atomic bomb. Rather, the dispute was sometimes a symbolic issue in a culture war in which many Americans lumped together the seeming decline of American power, the difficulties of the domestic economy, the threats in world trade, and especially Japan's successes, the loss of domestic jobs, and even changes in American gender roles and shifts in the American family. To a number of Americans, the very people responsible for the script were the people who were changing America. The bomb, representing the end of World War II and suggesting the height of American power, was to be celebrated. It was, in this judgment, a crucial symbol of America's good war, one fought justly for noble purposes at a time when America was united. Those who in any way questioned the bomb's use were, in the emotional framework, the enemies of America." Thus, the issue of how the atomic bomb should be remembered, according to Howard, transcended the debate surrounding the dropping of the bomb and evoked responses that were informed by present-day issues. The bomb represented the height of American military power, the same power that had declined since the Vietnam War. It reminded Americans of the era when they were unconquerable and able to end the most devastating war in history with 2 mighty blows. Thus, an exhibition that in any way questioned the use of the atomic bomb was considered to be an attack on that memory. In the end, the planned exhibition was replaced by a simple display of the fuselage of Enola Gay with little historical context. It was accompanied by a video presentation that included interviews with the crew before and after the mission. While the simplification of the exhibit was intended to quiet most of the criticism, especially those from the American region, the final exhibit did not satisfy everyone. Numerous historians and scholars calling themselves the Committee for Open Debate on Hiroshima protested the exhibit in a letter to the Secretary of the Smithsonian on the 31st of July 1995, calling on the Smithsonian either to eliminate the highly contentious interpretations or, at the very least, balance them with other interpretations. Meanwhile, the artifacts on loan from Hiroshima and Nagasaki and the graphic photos of victims were relocated to the American University Museum. This exhibition opened on the 9th of July 1995 with minimal protests. It was entitled Constructing a Peaceful World Beyond Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Officials from the university stated that it was not intended as a replacement for the Enola Gay exhibition at the Smithsonian. Phil Boudin, a spokesperson for the American region, stated in a New York Times article that the Smithsonian is a federal agency supported by taxpayer money, and rightly or wrongly, what it portrays is seen as the United States version of history. At the American University, those constraints don't apply. The exhibition of the fuselage ran from January 1995 to May 1998. Despite all the controversies, this exhibit drew more than a million visits in its first year alone, and a total of nearly 4 million visitors by the time it closed. It would be one of the most popular special exhibitions in the history of the Air and Space Museum. In 2003, the Smithsonian announced the opening of the Annex NASM facility, the Stephen F. Udvar-Hazy Center. Located near Dulles Airport, it provides a permanent home for Enola Gay, as originally proposed back in 1988. In its first 2 weeks, the center had more than 200,000 visitors. But this exhibition of the Enola Gay also did not escape controversy. In February 2005, a group calling itself the Committee for National Discussion of Nuclear History and Current Policy described the exhibition of the Enola Gay as a technological achievement, as an extraordinary callousness towards the victims, indifference to the deep divisions among American citizens about the propriety of these actions, and disregard for the feelings of most of the world's peoples. In addition, two men were even arrested for throwing red paint which dented the plane during protests on opening day. The Genabaku Dome, or the Atomic Bomb Dome, or A-Bomb Dome, is part of the Product Exhibition Hall building built in 1915 on the banks of the Motoyasu River in the city of Hiroshima. The design included a distinctive dome at the highest part of the building in 1933 it was renamed the Hiroshima Prefectural Industrial Promotions Hall. At 8:15 on the morning of 6 August 1945, the little boy atomic bomb was dropped in Hiroshima. It was supposed to detonate over the Aoi Bridge, but instead it exploded over the Shima Hospital, which was very close to the Genabaku Dome. It's estimated that the hypocenter of the blast occurred 150 meters horizontally and 600 meters vertically from the dome. The building's vertical columns were able to resist the nearly vertical downward force of the blast, and parts of the concrete and brick outer walls remained intact, but everyone inside the building was killed instantly. The dome became a subject of controversy after the bombing, because some locals wanted the ruins torn down completely, while others wanted to preserve it as a memorial park of the bombing and a symbol of peace. Ultimately, when the reconstruction of Hiroshima began, the building structure was preserved. Hiroshima City Council adopted a resolution in 1966 on the permanent preservation of the Genabaku Dome, officially named the Hiroshima Peace Memorial. The dome continues to be a primary landmark, with many visitors believing that it is actually ground zero for the atomic bomb explosion. In fact, there is a small memorial next to the rebuilt Shima Hospital pinpointing Ground Zero. From 1945 from 1950 through to 1964, the Hiroshima Peace Memorial Park was established around the dome. The park is situated between the Motoyasu and Ota rivers. It includes the Genobaku Dome, which now serves as the Hiroshima Peace Memorial, as well as the Cenotaph, a museum, and Memorial Hall. In 1996, Japan and the International Council on Monuments and Sites, or ICOMOS, proposed that the Genobaku Dome be registered on the UNESCO World Heritage List based on the Convention for the Protection of the World Cultural and Natural Heritage. Its proposed inclusion was based on its survival from a destructive force, which was the atomic bomb, the first use of nuclear weapons on the human population, and its representation as a symbol of peace. Delegates to the World Heritage Committee from the United States and China had reservations regarding the confirmation of the memorial as a World Heritage Site. China cited the possibility that the monument could be used to downplay the fact that the victim countries of Japan's aggression suffered the greatest losses of life during the war, and the United States stated that having a memorial to a war site would omit the necessary historical context. The US completely disassociated itself from the decision. This kind of opposition to the site being declared a World Heritage Site reflects the contested nature of the legacy of the dome. While the Japanese view it as a symbol of peace, the US and Chinese view it as a symbol of war when the Japanese aggressors sought to vanquish their countries. The purpose of the Peace Memorial Park is not only to memorialize the victims, but also to perpetuate the memory of nuclear horrors and advocate world peace. Each year, on the 6th of August, the Peace Memorial Ceremony, which is sponsored by the city of Hiroshima, is also held in the park. The ceremony is held in front of the memorial cenotaph in the Hiroshima in the park. Participants include the families of the deceased and people from all over the world. The first ceremony was held in 1947. As a result, Hiroshima is branded as a place of peace rather than the site of a war crime. But despite this, no US president had ever visited the park until May 2016, when US President Barack Obama toured the park with Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe and delivered a speech paying tribute to the victims of the bomb. Many Japanese and international peace activists called on Obama to apologize for the use of the atomic bomb against the Japanese, but he insisted that no such apology would be issued. Instead, Obama in his speech generalized the brutality that humankind had brought on to itself. He said, "Nations arise telling a story that binds people together in sacrifice and cooperation, allowing for remarkable feats, but those same stories have so often been used to oppress and dehumanize those who are different. Science allows us to communicate across the seas, fly above the clouds, to cure disease and understand the cosmos, but those same discoveries can be turned into ever more efficient killing machines. The wars of the modern age teach us this truth. Hiroshima teaches this truth." Obama concluded by re-emphasizing the purpose of the park by noting, "That is why we come to this place. We stand here in the middle of this city and force ourselves to imagine the moment the bomb fell. We force ourselves to feel the dread of children confused by what they see. We listen to a silent cry. We remember all the innocents killed across the arc of that terrible war, and the wars that came before, and the wars that would follow. Mere words cannot give voice to such suffering. But we have a shared responsibility to look directly into the eye of history and ask what we must do differently to curb such suffering again." After the speech, Obama met with three hibakusha, or survivors of the blast. The term literally means person who is affected by a bomb or person affected by exposure to radioactivity. Although it was used before the Hiroshima and Nagasaki bombings to label those affected by any kind of aerial bombing, the use of the term was narrowed down to describe the survivors of the atomic bomb attacks. The Hibakusha and their children were, and still are, victims of severe discrimination due to public ignorance about the consequences of radiation sickness, with much of the public believing it to be hereditary or contagious. This is despite the fact that there was no real evidence to suggest an increase of birth defects or congenital malformations among the later conceived children born to the Hibakusha. According to a study conducted by the Radiation Effects Research Foundation, or the RERF, the female Hibakusha of Hiroshima and Nagasaki who were exposed to substantial amounts of radiation but could conceive birthed children with no higher incidence of abnormalities or birth defects than the rate which is observed in the Japanese average. Given that the Hibakusha's experiences were unique and that their memories were so overwhelming to capture, artists and writers struggled to find new forms and a new language to convey their stories. Thus, artistic representations of the unprecedented events were largely avoided or deferred due to the unprecedented nature of the atomic bombs, firstly, where witnesses were left confounded by an event that had no historical precedent, no prior imagery or vocabulary that could give form to the sudden destruction of an entire city existed. Even the tragic after effects went beyond the bounds of previous photo documentary representation. Secondly, US censorship and the management of the official American narrative of the blasts. The official US narrative was restricted to images of the mushroom cloud, far above the death and destruction below. Information on the effects of the bomb were treated as sensitive, and the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission report of 1947, in which the effects of the bomb on survivors and infrastructure of both Hiroshima and Nagasaki were detailed, was classified for a very long time. Lastly, taboo subject matter. The Japanese were reluctant to talk about or listen to the stories of the Hibakusha. The kind of trauma experienced by the survivors was so painful and horrific that there seemed to be a silent decision that any artistic representation of the atomic bomb should be avoided for fear of reawakening that trauma. Genbaku Bungaku, or atomic bomb literature, is a Japanese literary genre used to describe writing about the atomic bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The term came into wide use in the 1960s. The genre includes diaries, testimonial or documentary accounts, poetry, drama or fictional works about the bombings and their aftermath. The formation of the genre was accompanied by a struggle between various interpretive codes as to how representations of the dropping of the atomic bombs should be interpreted. The genre began almost immediately after the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, even though the term A-bomb literature would only become popular in the 1960s. In addition, the genre extended to include works by non-Japanese authors, for example, John Hersey's Hiroshima, originally published in the New Yorker in 1946. Hersey had been a war correspondent writing for Life magazine and the New Yorker. He was one of the first Western journalists to view the ruins of Hiroshima after the bombing and was commissioned by William Shawn, assistant editor of the New Yorker, to write articles about the impact of a nuclear explosion by using witness accounts. This was a subject virtually untouched by American journalists. Hersey interviewed many witnesses, but focused on six in particular. His article, later converted into book form, contained detailed description of the bomb's effects. Hersey described the horrifying aftermath of the atomic device, with people with melted eyeballs or people vaporized, leaving only their shadows etched onto walls. The article was an immediate bestseller and was sold out at newsstands within hours. Published a little more than a year after the atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, the American public was shown a different interpretation of the Japanese from what had been previously described in their media. Scientists, along with the American public, felt shame and guilt at the suffering of the people of Hiroshima. As voiced by witnesses in Hiroshima, the people of the city did not blame the Americans for the infection, but instead their own government. It was widely thought that the Japanese government would have destroyed the entire country before losing the war. Hersey's plain prose was praised by critics as a model of understated narrative. In his obituary to Hersey in 1993, Hendrik Hartzenberg wrote, "If ever there was a subject calculated to make a writer overwrought and a piece overwritten, it was the bombing of Hiroshima." Yet, Hersey's reporting was so meticulous, his sentences and paragraphs were so clear, calm, and restrained, that the horror of the story he had to tell came through all the more chillingly. Time magazine said about Hersey's text, "Every American who has permitted himself to make jokes about atom bombs, or who has come to regard them as just one sensational phenomenon that can now be accepted as part of civilization, like the airplane and the gasoline engine, or who has allowed himself to speculate as to what we might do with them if we were forced into another war, ought to read Mr. Hersey." When the magazine article appears in book form, the critics will say that it is in its fashion a classic, but it is rather more than that. The magazine later termed Hiroshima the most celebrated piece of journalism to come out of World War II. In January 1965, Masuji Ibuse's story Black Rain began to be serialized in the Japanese magazine Shincho. The novel is about a young Japanese woman, Yasuko, who was exposed to radiation following the bombing of Hiroshima. Yasuko struggles to find a suitable husband because of a rumor that she suffers from radiation sickness despite a clean bill of health. When her newest suitor requests proof of her whereabouts during the bombing, Yasuko's uncle asked his wife to copy out Yasuko's journal as proof that she was not exposed. Ibuse uses this plot device to weave Yasuko's journal entries, and later those of her uncles, into his narrative. Black Rain is based on accounts and notes from Hibakusha, which Ibuse interviewed. The novel had been called cold or clinical by some critics, but the documentary style allows Ibuse to reveal Japanese customs and culture in an affirmation of normalcy in abnormal situations. Black Rain was later adapted into a movie of the same name in 1988, directed by Shuhei Imamura. The film was a critical success in Japan, winning 9 Japanese Academy Awards, including Best Film, Best Director, and Best Screenplay. Film critic Andrew Schenker praises Imamura's adaptation as a fatalistic chronicling of the aftermath of the Hiroshima bombing. He writes, "Here, everything is in breakdown. Even if the characters, like Imamura's camera, desperately attempt to assert normality, in this case by chanting sutras or arranging marriages. But as latent illness threatens all the people exposed to the blast, so the old order simply won't hold. Madness breaks out, men can no longer work, sudden deaths upset the family structure, and Imamura obliges by intercutting striking scenes of impressionistic horror amid the surface calm, as when the soldier experiences a wartime flashback and the director amps up the light and sound accordingly, or pins down haunting images of unrest, repeated shots of the household clock, marked by the shadows of the hands that were burnt into the face at the moment of meltdown." The film ends on a somber note, where it feels like the world is ending, long after the initial horror. One by one, the survivors start to succumb to radiation poisoning, and the social order around the protagonist crumbles completely. As Schenker notes, "Under the shadow of the bomb, hope is short-lived, and, in Imamura's fatalistic vision, individual agency is soon dissolved by the forces of history." Now, in the last section of representations of the Hiroshima bombing, we will deviate slightly and look at the role of comics in popularizing the stories of the Hibakusha in Japan. In the past, there seemed to be a popular misperception that comics was reserved for children due to the easily understandable images and accompanying text that left little room for imagination, stimulating children's ability to follow a story. However, Jeff Adams notes that the technical innovations of the visual forms combined with the social, political, and historical engagement of such texts. The sophistication of visual representation attracted and continues to attract an extensive adult audience, especially in Japan. Now, manga are comics or graphic novels originating from Japan. Most manga conform to a style developed in Japan in the late 19th century, and the form has a long prehistory in earlier Japanese art. The term manga is used in Japan to refer to both comics and cartooning. Outside of Japan, the word is typically used to refer to comics originally published in the country. In Japan, people of all ages read manga. The medium includes works in a broad range of genres. Since the 1950s, manga has become an increasingly major part of the Japanese publishing industry. Now, during World War II, manga was employed for propagandistic purposes by the Japanese militaristic regime. It was used to promote fighting spirit, stir up hatred of the enemy, and encourage people to economize. After the war, manga was also employed to promote and encourage the US occupation of Japan. Manga is often developed in tandem with cinematic animation, also known as anime. Now, Barefoot Gen is a Japanese historical manga series by Keiji Nagazawa. It was first serialized from 1973 to 1974 in 39 issues of Shonen Jump, the largest weekly comic in Japan with a readership of over 2 million people. The series was loosely based on Nagazawa's own experiences as a hibakusha. It starts in 1945 in and around Hiroshima, where the 6-year-old boy Gen Nakaoka lives with his family. After Hiroshima is destroyed by an atomic bomb, Gen and other survivors are left to deal with the aftermath. Nakazawa's evocative and emotional story gripped readers from all over Japan, drawing wide acclaim from teachers, parents, critics, and Shonen Jump's young, primarily male readers. The series was cancelled, though, after a year and a half because it was considered too harsh by the publishers. It was subsequently moved to 3 other less widely distributed magazines and published in 10-volume book collections in Japan beginning in 1975. In 1976, a volunteer pacifist organization called Project Gen was formed in Tokyo to produce English translations. The 10-volume Japanese version was translated into English. The 4 best-known volumes are titled Story of Hiroshima, The Day After, Life After the Bomb, and Out of the Ashes. Nakazawa's narrative is based on his own experiences as a survivor. He recounts how his alter ego, Gen, who is part of his family and the rest, struggled to survive in the aftermath of the atomic blast. In reality, Nagazawa also lost most of his family members in the blast after they became trapped under the debris of their house. His mother and an infant sister initially survived, but the baby died several weeks later, either from malnutrition or radiation from Nagazawa's mother. In Barefoot Gen, the reader views the events from the perspective of an innocent child's perspective, but Nagazawa also employs the use of an omniscient narrator. The characters are drawn in a way that makes them relatable, especially Gen. They have welcoming features such as Disney-type expressive eyes. Their appearance tends to be what Art Spiegelman calls cloyingly cute. This drastically changes once the bomb is dropped. Some characters morph into unrecognizable creatures, with eyeballs hanging outside their sockets, skin hanging and dripping, hair missing, horrifying specters who are categorized by Gen as ghosts, even though they are still technically alive. Barefoot Gen was made into an animated film in 1983, directed by Mori Masaki, and a sequel, Barefoot Gen 2 of 1986, was directed by Toshio Hirata. In his manga, Nakazawa accuses both the American and the Japanese as being complicit to the death and suffering into Hiroshima, but he insists that the Japanese military and imperial state misled civilians to wholesale destruction and suffering, and implies that the atomic bomb could have been averted by timely surrender. There seems to be an implication that Nagasawa suggests that the Hibakusha blamed the Americans for their plight, with a scene depicting an attack on a US prisoner of war. But as Nagasawa tries to put it, Barefoot Gen is anti-war rather than anti-American. Nagasawa also asserts that the Hibakusha do not wish to see themselves as victims, even though the rest of the world treats them differently. They just want to get on with their lives. Xenophobia also seems to stem quite strongly out of Nagasawa's narrative. For example, Gen's Korean neighbor, Mr. Park, finds that Japan's doctors refuse to treat his seriously injured father. Puck's father eventually dies after being denied food rations because of his Korean nationality. By including this to the narrative, Nagasawa manages to nuance the idea of victimhood even further, alluding to the historical record that captured the oppression and abuse suffered by Korean and Chinese nationals under the Japanese militarist regime. But despite the horrors that Gen, or Nagasawa, witnessed, Gen retains an indomitable spirit. His humanity and the humanity of his friends and surviving family members triumph in the face of unprecedented horror and an uncertain and bleak future. Gen holds on to his unmitigated faith in humankind's capacity for goodness and persistence. As such, Gen serves as an inspiration for newer generations to reject war and any warmongering tendencies. In conclusion, this lecture has shown the various controversies surrounding how the dropping of the first atomic bomb in anger should be remembered. The victorious USA considered the dropping of the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki as the defining acts that ended World War II. It's apparent that they will only consider Hiroshima synonymous with the end of World War II and the provision of peace in this context. But there are also those within the US who are vehemently opposed to this sort of glorification of an event which they feel is tantamount to being a war crime. On the other hand, the defeated Japanese reconstructed themselves and their values in the early post-war years as a nation looking towards peace and reconstruction. But has this outlook been well received and accepted by the countries which had been victims of Japan's militarism? What are their opinions on how Japan's end in the war should be remembered and memorialized? With regards to those who stood on Ground Zero, personal accounts had been suppressed and regarded as taboo, but these accounts did not go away and soon found themselves permeating the popular culture in Japan. In Barefoot Gen, Nakazawa's own personal witnessing of the bomb added the authentic form of expression. Barefoot Gen transcends, or transgresses, familiar framings of the atomic bombings through its narrative, as well as its imagery and text, while drawing on the conventions typified in manga. By doing so, it defamiliarizes already received images of history in order to bring forward a graphic story into popular culture. Next time, we will look at the reactions to the dawn of the age of atomic weapons and how cultural expressions have arisen to articulate these reactions. This phenomenon would become known as the atomic culture.